I lower my bow. I start climbing down in my tree stand, the climbing stand. I hop out. I go over to the deer. And I remember it was very emotional. I'm freaking out. I'm sick as could be. But then I walk back over to get my tree stand. And the tree stand is about 15 feet in the air. I was so excited. I climbed down. And in my mind, I was like, close enough. And I'm lucky I didn't break my legs. I realized that, I don't know if it was when I jumped, I couldn't find my knife. So I had to take this deer out like she was back to my car. I get home and I had to go back with my brother and a ladder in the dark to get my damn climbing tree stand.
Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast, episode number 229. Tony Caggiano, Wold Slam Adventures, Patience, and Respect Their Senses. Please support our sponsors as they make this show possible. Today's show is sponsored by Black Ash Outdoor Products. Reduce your risk of tree stand suspension trauma with a tree stand wingman, the tree stand emergency descender system. The Enforcer, take control of your odor footprint with your personal ozone generator. The Rack Packer, don't drag your deer out of the woods like a caveman. Never drag a deer again. No need to kill yourself dragging a deer when there's the Rack Packer. Use the promo code BIGBUCK, B-I-G-B-U-C-K, at checkout to earn free shipping at $23 value. Go to therackpacker.com. Covert Scouting Cameras, remote cameras for hunting, wildlife, and security. The Horny Buck Seed Company, it's all about the freshest seed. Morse's Sporting Goods, a full line of sporting goods without the sales tax. Northwoods Common Sense, New England's finest whitetail deer lures, 100% fresh, pure, and undiluted. And Big Buck Merch, for only $19.99. You can get a cool, high-quality Big Buck t-shirt and show support for this podcast by visiting www.bigbuckregistry.com/merch. Big Buck Registry is a virtual museum of hunting stories. We preserve a piece of Americana by interviewing and recording hunters about their hunts and experiences from across the country. And who knows, maybe we'll learn a thing or two along the way that'll help us take our hunt to the next level.
Hey, this is Don Higgins from Higgins Outdoors and Real World Wildlife Products. Tune in and hear one of my favorite podcasts, The Big Buck Registry.
Hey, this is Hal Blood from Big Woods Bucks. And you're about to push play on my favorite podcast, The Big Buck Registry.
Hi, my name is Joe Donito. I'm one of the Adirondack trackers at adktrackers.com. And you're about to listen to my favorite podcast, Big Buck Registry.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and fellow predators. My name is Jay, and thank you for tuning in to the Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast. For Dusty Phillips and Jim Keller and the entire staff here at the Big Buck Registry, welcome to this week's show. There are a couple things I'd like you to do for us if you could. If you would, please check us out on iTunes, subscribe, and leave us a review. With your help, we're going to try and push this show up the iTunes charts. I know we have a lot of listeners out there, and I need you to take some action. I need you to leave a review and subscribe to the show. If you do subscribe, that'll give you access and notification each and every week that a new show is released. You can also access this show in its entirety on YouTube, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and Google Play. It's all right there for you to access on demand at your fingertips. Regarding the harness program, we have an ample supply of harnesses to give away from our volunteer donors. If you're in need of a full-body harness, please send an email to jay@bigbuckregistry.com. If you've ever explored the many hunting services that are available today, you've probably had some experiences that left you wanting more, both on the front end and the actual hunt itself. This is exactly what drove Tony Caggiano to start Wold Slam Adventures while exploring a Wold Slam turkey hunt. Today, Tony offers his knowledge and experience of hunting to those seeking world-class hunting experiences. Still, despite having access to hunting around the world, Tony says he still enjoys coming home to deer hunt in his own woods. We'll get to our interview with Tony Caggiano in just one moment, but before we do, let's turn to Jim Keller with the deer news.
For the Big Buck Registry, this is Jim Keller with the deer news. Our first story this week, Dent County, Missouri man charged for illegally releasing swine after discovery of criminal hog hunting ring. This story is from the SalemNewsOnline.com. Try that again, Jay. This story is from the SalemNewsOnline.com website and was reported by Andrew Sheely. A Dent County man has been charged in connection to a multi-county feral hog hunting ring in which swine were illegally released by individuals for the purposes of hunting, according to court documents filed November 3rd in Dent County Associate Court. Michael L. Bennett, 25, of Jadwin, has been charged with 7 misdemeanor counts of release of swine to live in the wild or feral state. Each county carries a potential sentence of 1 year in jail and $2,000 fine. According to the case's probable cause reported by a Missouri Department of Conservation agent, 2 feral hogs were killed on private property in Shannon County September 22nd. Agents with MDC responded to the scene and discovered each swine weighed at least 100 pounds and was tagged with the USDA bright tags in their ears. The tags were traced to the Somerville Stockyard in Shannon County. A search warrant executed at the stockyard September 29th obtained sales records identifying Bennett as the purchaser of the 2 hogs in question, as well as 5 others. A birch tree man was identified as the hog seller. MDC officials have killed 38 feral hogs within 4 miles of the birch tree man's property since May 2017. The report says Bennett supplied a written statement he bought the pigs for fattening up, but they'd escaped from his pen. However, an inspection of the pen by the agent concludes Bennett hadn't made necessary purchases or preparations to either keep or fatten up the swine. The report further states that during the interview, Bennett gave the conservation agent names of other individuals with whom he'd gone hunting with for feral hogs. No other charges in connection to the feral hog hunting ring have been filed. Hunter shoots, kills woman after mistaking her for a deer, officials say. This story is from the FoxNews.com website. A hunter in western New York shot and killed a woman out walking her dogs on the evening of Wednesday, November 22nd, after mistaking her for a deer. Thomas Jedlowski, 34, believed he saw a deer in a field about 200 yards away from him when he shot Rosemary Bilquist in the hip with a high-powered pistol. The 40-year-old woman was walking her 2 Labrador retrievers in the field behind her home in Sherman. Rushing toward Bilquist after hearing her scream, Jedlowski called 911 and applied pressure on her wound until paramedics arrived. Bilquist was taken to the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center in Erie, Pennsylvania, where she was pronounced dead. While no charges have been filed against Jedlowski, and he has been cooperating with investigators, the shooting was reported at 5:24 p.m., which is 40 minutes after sunset. It is against New York state law to hunt deer after sunset. Jamie Bilquist also said his wife was shot on the next-door neighbor's property and that Jedlowski didn't have permission to be hunting on the property. The Chautauqua County Sheriff's Office is working with investigators from the New York Department of Environmental Conservation and the local district attorney's office to decide if charges should be filed. "This is a horrific incident," Sheriff Joe Garris said. "This has destroyed 2 lives." Bilquist's husband took to social media on Thanksgiving to express his sadness over his wife's death and thank family and friends for their support. Missouri Department of Conservation reports November firearms deer harvest ends with 191,000 plus. This story is from the Missouri Department of Conservation website. Preliminary data from the Missouri Department of Conservation, the MDC, shows that deer hunters in Missouri harvested 191,368 deer during the November portion of fall firearms deer season, November 11th through the 21st. Of the 191,368 deer harvested, 99,431 were antlered bucks, 20,148 were button bucks, and 71,789 were does. Last year, hunters checked 185,062 deer during the 2016 November portion of the firearm deer season, with 95,381 being antlered bucks, 18,888 being button bucks, and 70,793 being does. Top harvest counties were Howell with 4,564 deer checked, Texas County with 4,374 deer checked, and Franklin with 4,095. The uptick in harvest this year is likely due to a combination of favorable weather and the continued recovery of deer population in some areas hit hard by the 2012 drought, MDC deer biologist Barb Keller said. MDC reported 3 firearms-related hunting incidents during the fall firearms November portion. One of the county incidents involved a hunter wounding another hunter while hunting in Benton County. Another incident in Washington County involved a hunter loading a gun in a truck and it went off, hitting another hunter sitting in the truck. Lastly, another hunting incident involved a self-inflicted firearm wound that occurred in Bates County. Deer hunting in Missouri continues with archery season hunting from November 22nd through January 15th, 2018. The late youth portion of the firearms deer season runs November 24th through 26th. The antlerless portion of the firearms deer season runs December 1st through 3rd. Lastly, the alternative methods portion will run December 23rd to January 2nd, 2018. Missouri offers some of the best deer hunting in the country, and deer hunting is an important part of many Missourians' lives and family traditions. Deer hunting is also an important economic driver in Missouri and gives a $1 billion annual boost to the state and local economies. Missouri hunter bags 39-point buck after 4 years of trying. This story is from the Fox News website. A Missouri hunter finally landed his ultimate prize, a 39-point buck dubbed the St. Paul Giant. Tim Phillips wrote on Facebook he was, quote-unquote, lucky enough to bag the buck on Saturday, November 11th, after hunting the animal for several years. Believe it or not, this isn't even the first time Phillips or someone he knew had actually shot this specific buck. Phillips told KFVS a woman shot the same deer in 2014 and that his dad struck it with a bow just 9 days before he took it down. In the latter case, Phillips said he and his father tried tracking the wounded deer with dogs, but to no avail. Not long afterward, though, he was able to bag the buck on his own. For the most part, at least, Phillips also made sure to thank his wife for putting up with his obsession. That concludes this week's edition of the Big Buck Registry's Deer News. Special thanks to Daniel Applebaum, who provided all stories this week. For links to the stories featured this week, please check our show notes at www.bigbuckregistry.com. If you have any ideas for future topics or have any questions about any of these topics, please email me at jim@bigbuckregistry.com. For the Big Buck Registry, this is Jim Keller with the Deer News.
Thanks to Jim Keller for the Deer News. Without further ado, here's Tony Caggiano. Tony Caggiano, welcome to the Big Buck Registry Deer Hunting Podcast. How are you, my friend?
I'm good, man. Thanks for having me.
It's like to talk to you. You've got a cool thing going on over there at Wold Slam Adventures.
Yeah, I'm a lucky guy. You know, things worked out. I had an idea. I started to put things into motion a few years ago, and now here I am. I got to do it for a living, so it's been a pretty good run so far, and it's looking better and better all the time. So having fun.
Where do you call home, Tony?
Currently, I'm living in Dutchess County, New York, a town of Amenia and Millbrook, right on the border there. So about 2 hours north of New York City.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So that's some good country out there. Is that the headquarters of all things Wold Slam oriented?
Yeah, I have an office at my home, and I work out of there now. For 18 and a half years, I ran a private club called Tamarack Preserve in Millbrook, New York.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, so I've been a guide, a full-time hunting guide, and the events director there for a number of years. And this, the Wold Slam thing kind of spawned from that. So I've been up here for about 20 years now. And it's interesting because people just do not realize the hunting opportunities in New York. I think a lot of people across the country hear New York and they think of Manhattan, New York City. And it's such a small part of the state. It's a huge state with, the largest national park is in national forest land is here in the Adirondack Park. So there's a lot of ground and a lot of wildlife and incredible hunting here.
Sure. Absolutely. I think of New York as a very plentiful place for wildlife.
Yeah.
And for hunters to partake in that aspect of life. Yeah, it's a rich ground, definitely.
Yeah, and then here in the Hudson Valley, it's exceptional, even more so than many other parts of the state, I think.
Right, right. Yeah, definitely. And fishing, too, it seems like. You know, the whole area is good for striped bass, and yeah, it's just a melting pot of all kinds of things.
Yeah, if you're a sportsman, it's a great place to be, honestly.
Right, right. I agree. So yeah. How did this whole Wold Slam thing get going?
So, as I said, I was running this club, and I was one of the guides there, and I had a couple of different clients who were members. So it's different than being an outfitter where I'm working with a lot of the same guys over and over on request. The members would come, and you kind of build up this little group that you click with, and everyone they come up, I'm guiding them and doing our thing. And one day, a couple of the guys, we got to talking after a hunt. And they said, oh, we'd love to do a turkey hunt sometime. We should go out and chase some Rio Grandes. Mm. And I started looking into it. And everywhere I went, it was either I was calling up guys that I didn't know and I couldn't really get a lot of information on. So I felt like I was rolling the dice. I wasn't sure about sending money and taking a bunch of my own clients someplace I've never been. And then if I went to one of the bigger booking agencies, it seemed like the hunts were a number. So like, oh, well, how about Rio Grande hunt number 242 or Rio Grande hunt 18? And also, it kind of put me off that they weren't more in touch with the hunts. And also, being a turkey hunt, the booking agents work on commission. And when you're talking about a Rio Grande turkey hunt, you're not talking about a high ticket item. So to work with me and a few guys, they're going to walk away with a couple hundred bucks at best. And it seemed like I felt, and I'm not going to say which company, but I felt like second-class citizen because I was a turkey hunter in this instance. I mean, I hunt everything, but that's what we were looking to book. So I reached out to some of the guys I know in the industry, guys like Ray I and Brian Lovett, who ran Turkey and Turkey Hunting Magazine and is now with Realtree, and a bunch of guys in the industry. And I started asking them, like, who have you been with? Like, who have you hunted with? Who do you recommend? And they started pointing me in the right direction. And when I sat down with these outfitters, I'm out there, went down on a Rio Grande hunt, and we sat down with these guys, and it's like they're in the same boat. The bigger guys didn't want to deal with it because there wasn't enough money in it. So I started Wold Slam Adventures, and the name Wold Slam comes from the Wold Slam of Turkey, the six subspecies. And I started off specializing in wild turkey hunts. And I did it as what I offer is a concierge service, because that's where I was coming from. It was a private club environment, and the guys I was working with really wanted a high-end experience. And I have guys who call me up and say, I want to go Rio Grande turkey hunting. Tell me where I'm going, basically. And I did everything soup to nuts. And I was doing it was more of a passion project, just because it was something I love. And since then, it's kind of snowballed into big game and waterfowling and other forms of wing shooting and fishing, because these guys kept coming back. And after killing a Wold Slam with me, they're like, hey, I want to go chase whitetails. I want to go chase coos deer, mule deer. And that's really, you know, and so here I am today, kind of snowballed on that end for Wold Slam.
Gotcha. All right.
Yeah.
Fascinating little journey there.
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun. It's one of those things where I just thought the end game was getting a bunch of – it started out with the only end game I was looking forward to was I had a group of five buddies who happened to be clients, but they're good friends. And I was just looking to get us on some good hunts and enjoy myself. It wasn't about being a job. And word got out, and a lot of guys started reaching out to me, avid turkey hunters.
Yeah.
And next thing I know, I'm working 40 to 60 hours a week, depending on the season, and then coming home and working till, at the time when I was doing it full time at the club, I'm working till 2 and 3 in the morning, just to keep up with it. Which was, I'm not complaining. It was great, but it was just one of those things where I was always on.
Right, right.
But that's the kind of thing you do to start out. You know, that's right. How I looked at it. It was, you pay your dues.
Do you? And this is like a classic situation. Do you feel like, do you hunt, get out and hunt too, like as recreationally, or are you, like you said, you're always on? Is there ever a downtime, and is that downtime dedicated to your hunting adventures as opposed to somebody else's?
Yeah, it all started because I love hunting. And I see a lot of guys that want to be guides. Even when I was a guide, like, how do you get into it? What do you want? How did you do it? And the story how I got into it is kind of, you know, just, it fell in my lap, really, from things I was doing. But I've always tried to stick with and do the things I love to do. So if I did a hunt and I had hosted hunts, I always went with buddies of mine at the beginning, and it was friends. So it was a lot of fun. When I had kids, my boys are 9 and 11 now. So it was a little more difficult when they were younger, but now they're into it. And so they come along with me. They're not really old enough to hunt in New York State, unfortunately, but they tag along and we do other hunts other places. But yeah, I've always loved hunting, and I always tried to make time for my own aside from the business end of it.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
I asked that question because a lot of times, you know, the plumber won't fix their own sink, you know,
yeah,
that kind of thing. So
I'll tell you, go ahead. For most guys, and me included, the best way to screw up your own hunting experience is to start to do it professionally, because while I'm not saying that my hunting experience isn't good, I have a great time, but everything, I mean, even if you love something, at a certain point, it becomes your job. You focus on it. There's stress involved. Being a hunting guide, you're worried about the client's experience. You're worried about the safety is always an issue, especially when you're with new people. And say when I was a guide, I'm doing upland hunts with my dogs, and we're chasing pheasants and quail, and you want to be sure everyone is safe. That quickly became the top priority. When you're a guide, you think getting out there and hunting and the game is number one. And then you realize, well, the important thing is that we all go home at the end of this. You know, pheasants are really cool, but it's just a bird. Like, you always got to have people keeping that in mind and you stay on top of it. But as you mature in it and you get older and it becomes second nature, that sort of stuff. And then I got back to really enjoying doing it.
Gotcha. So,
okay. Yeah, it was kind of like this ebb and flow. All of a sudden, it was amazing. I'm a hunting guide now. You go in, and then it becomes really stressful for a little while, and you worry about different aspects of the hunt. And now I used to worry so much that they got their game, and now I just worry, hey, we're safe, and everybody had a great hunting experience. That's the important thing.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Well, do you recall or recollect your earliest hunting experience?
My earliest? Yeah, I was – we were – it's not really – per se a hunting experience, but I grew up, most of my mother's family was down in Florida. So we would go down to the panhandle of Florida.
Okay.
And down there, the dove hunting was king. Everybody loved the dove hunting. And you know, when I went down there, I met my cousins and we were in Dufuniak Springs, Florida, which is in the middle of nowhere. And we spent the summer running around with pellet guns. You know, maybe I'm putting this out there. I'm 11 years old and at that time in the 70s, the kids weren't concerned with the hunting season. They were hunting doves, you know, sitting out there on the edge of these fields. And that was the first time I'd ever eaten wild game. We spent the whole summer, my cousins spent the whole summer to get enough doves to have one barbecue before we went back home to New York. But when I really got into hunting was I grew up in the Bronx, yep, in the city. I went to school down there. My family moved north to Westchester and I had a friend who was into bow hunting and he got me into it.
Oh, cool.
It started out because I loved shooting the bow and, I bought a bow and, it was an Oneida Strike Eagle, which at the time was really hot stuff, you know, 300 feet per second. People were noon and on, but turns out at the time it was difficult to keep in tune and all that, but I didn't know any better.
Yeah.
And, but yeah, the first season of bow, and I got into the bow hunting. I remember the first season of bow hunting. At that point, I had no one that I hunted with. My buddy just really introduced me to the bow. And it's a great but terrible story looking back on it. But I remember a deer. I see an 8-pointer, and he comes right underneath me, but there was a 12-pointer behind him. The only deer I had seen were in magazines. And at the time, a lot of guys, that's when it was getting really popular to put these farmed bucks in the magazines, and nobody knew about it. You know, so there were all these giant slammer deer. And I let this 8-pointer walk under me, and I was waiting for the 12, which was hanging back with a doe, knowing now he was never coming in. And two or three times I saw the same two deer through the season. Yep. Even during the rut, they stuck together. And another guy who hunted the neighboring property wound up shooting that 8-pointer, and it went about 160. And at the time, I had only seen deer in magazines, man. So, I wound up shooting a fawn doe that season, and I let that buck walk under me because I didn't know any better. You know what I mean? It wasn't
right.
I was like, oh, well, there's the two of them together. And the right, I don't know why. I could punch myself in the face right now. it was the big, yeah, still the largest deer I ever had in range of me. And I didn't know any better. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
I was going according to magazines and I was listening to other people's opinion on hunting, why you should be doing it and don't shoot the small deer and don't do this. And meanwhile, I should have just been enjoying my first deer experience, right, but I had no one to kind of teach me any better. I was not 18 years old and that's what I did. And looking back now, when people come out at me, I am the complete opposite of that. I just try to tell them, if you're excited and you're having fun, go for it. You know what I mean? If a first time hunter to sit around and wait for 180-inch deer, it's absurd to me.
Right.
But it's what I did in not knowing, but that was also 1991.
Right.
It's like looking back, it's like another world, another lifetime, you know?
So this was your experience out in Westchester County?
Yeah, in Westchester County. Okay. Things have changed a lot there. Back then, there were very few people living there compared to now.
Right.
You know, it's one of the priciest places in the country to live right now. And I believe this tree that I had my first tree stand in, it was actually a climbing stand that I used in the same tree. Shot my deer at it. It's in the backyard of like a $10 million home now, right in the middle of the yard. So that tells you the direction that area went in. But they still have really incredible hunting that people don't realize. But back then, I think it was the golden age of deer hunting in New York and Westchester County. It was just remarkable.
Yep. I didn't deer hunt down there, but I remember fondly fly fishing, the East Branch of the Croton, and catching some of those huge rainbows and browns that swim up and through there, and a huge, catch and release type scenario.
Just yeah.
Absolutely massive, massive fish.
Just beautiful area too. My first apartment when I got out of college was right there in Croton. We spent a lot of time there on the East Branch and yep. the mouth of the Croton. We did a lot of duck hunting before the town closed it down on the Hudson River there.
Yep.
We did a lot of duck hunting right there. And like I said, we were within 5 minutes, you had great duck hunting, great goose hunting, deer, turkey, fishing. Like you said, go down to the Hudson River when the stripers are running and catch these massive fish. So yeah, people didn't realize just an hour outside of New York City at that, and then in Croton. And it's just an incredible place for sportsmen, especially at the time.
I was always fascinated at how wonderful it was just as a sportsman to go and enjoy an afternoon of fly fish. Of course, I did get it got a little popular, and it was one of the few places I actually caught a hook in my cheek from the guy in front of me, not watching his back cast. But that's what happens.
Yeah, I've seen it before.
yep. So the World Slam had turned from turkey, which is kind of what we think of World Slam a lot, into big game hunting. And of course, we're more or less on this particular podcast interested in the big game type aspects. Tell us more about your big game adventures that you're going on and where you go. It looks like you're even going overseas.
Yeah, I do quite a bit overseas. So as a natural progression of World Slam, like I said, it started out more as a hobby just for me and my friends, and I figured a couple other guys might be interested. But I built up a really nice clientele of turkey hunters at the beginning. And these guys but they're avid hunters, they're big game hunters and they're fishermen. And so I tried to provide, and I still do, I strive to provide a great level of service where I take care of everything for you. From pick up at your house to drop off, I help with your taxidermy, tags, everything. And so a couple of guys started asking about deer hunting. So I started working with a couple of guys on deer hunts, booking a little bit of big game here and there. And it was funny because it was almost like I would tell guys, well, this is World Slam is the turkey deal. This is just on the side, just for you, for this guy, for individuals. And more outfitters started to reach out to me with different offerings. And so it just kind of unfolded that way. More guys doing different things. And then a deer hunter, one of the guys wanted to go for mule deer. He hunted whitetail at me. And then now I've expanded into Alaska. And I also, during this time, I had been taking groups down to Argentina, which I think, I was taking groups down to Argentina and doing some bird hunting there. And it started out just for fun. And then I kind of added that to the World Slam repertoire. And I started doing more and more with the companies in Argentina, David Denny's Bird Hunting and Nervous Waters Fly Fishing. And Red Stag Patagonia, which is the big game, became really good friends with the owner, who's actually – I'm picking him up Monday. He's coming here to Sebastian Casado. He's going to spend some time here. We're going to do a little hunting here in New York. But so the big game kind of has – I don't want to say it's taken over for the turkey, but it's just as big, if not bigger. And it's been going really well. I work with outfitters for whitetail and coos deer, mule deer. And also I do overseas. I do a lot of red stag hunting down in Argentina, where working with those companies down there, that morphed into me being invited to be their U.S. sales manager. So I'm running sales here in the States for 20 lodges that the company owns and operates across South America. And that's what allowed me to leave the hunting guide industry, leave my job as a hunting guide. Now I just do this full time between World Slam and the South American companies. But yeah, it's great fun. I hunted this year. I hunted out in Illinois. I didn't score on a buck. I saw some beauties, let a few walk that you wouldn't really let walk here in New York. It's just a different, the whitetail hunting in Illinois and in the Midwest, it's a completely different animal than we have here in New York, seeing a 130-inch buck, these guys are like, no, he's too young. And around here, that's where deer – it's a huge deer for around here. So things have really been going good with that. I've expanded. I've done the deer hunting down in Argentina. I do is I've hunted axis deer, incredible free-range axis deer, as well as red stag in the mountains of the foothills of the Andes. And other big game. Next week, I'm going to Spain to hunt ibex with a group from Mossberg and Swarovski.
No kidding.
So I'm doing wow. – yeah, so – it's a little bit off the big buck registries, probably your what your core is of whitetail, but it's amazing sure. stuff. And
yeah, In my view, and I'm sure a lot of people listen to this, it's whitetail, but in my view, it was created as the big buck registry. So any species that has a buck in it, it was fair game for us to talk about, which is great because it gives us a whole other aspect of different styles of hunting and animal behavior and different places in the world where these creatures live. So it really opens up a whole different avenue that allows us to explore. You know, it's different than whitetail hunting.
Yeah, and what I try to do with Wold Slam is, and my outfitters will tell you, and the folks that book with me, my clients and friends, like what I'm trying to do now is to create amazing hunting experiences because I'm 46 years old now. I've been hunting for 25 years, guided professionally for 20. And what's important to me isn't so much the number of the inches of bone as much as a great experience, going to a beautiful location, using different tactics. When we were in Illinois, I was using tree stands, and I loved my time in the tree watching the sun come up. But in Spain, I'm looking forward to glassing and stalking, in more open mountainous areas. When we're down in Argentina and Patagonia, it's wide open. You could see for 50 miles when you get on top of one of these hilltops, and there's not a tree in sight. So that's a completely different location, a different vibe, a different style of hunting. And ultimately, I enjoy new species. It's just so cool to see how different species act and react and all that good stuff. Down there for the red stag roar and listening to that at sunrise where they're all roaring, you hear half a dozen, a dozen stags roaring in every direction. Or when you go on an elk hunt, you hear the bugling. And hell, I was hunting a fallow deer and I hear this barking. Just grunting and barking, and here come 25 fallow deer chasing each other and fighting. That to me, that's really it. It's about a great experience. And so I'm really open to, I find myself where I was this guy who started out, I just want to turkey hunt and that's what I want to focus on. And it's changed my life to the point where I get to do this for a living. And also I'm seeing amazing new things all the time. And that's really what I'm trying to help people to see. It's about new experiences, you know?
Right. Over the course of your career doing the big game hunting, especially any kind of big game buck hunting, can you draw any similarities from species to species that would assist somebody as a generality going in to hunt anything? And what are some of the major differences that you're finding from species to species?
Yeah, I find that the thing that goes across the board is if you want to get and you want to hunt big, mature animals of any species, whether it's stag or elk, deer, goats, respect their senses. Do you know what I mean? Big animals, big, old, mature animals don't get that way by being stupid. And it sounds corny. You heard it 1,000 times. But I really – and it's not so much the scent. It's not any one thing other than just taking your time. These animals, they're not on your schedule. People, I find the biggest issue, the biggest mistake guys make, and even guys that I've guided myself, is to be in a rush. They don't – the guys who are consistently taking big, mature animals – they're on a different time schedule than us. They're thinking on the animal's time. It could take weeks for some of my friends I know who hunt really big, mature whitetails, even around here, to connect with these animals. A lot of time in the tree here, a lot of, whatever it is, it's just patience. And I know everybody says that it sounds a little corny, but it's really that to me. That's what I find. Slowing down, assessing the situation, and trying to keep all the things we all know, the wind in our favor, don't be seen, don't make too much noise. But across the board, I think it's just being patient when you're pursuing these animals and taking your time to notice the little things. That's where I find success. And the outfitters that I work with, and they're consistently having great success, they really are. That's the guys they are. That's who they are. They're just incredibly patient guys, men and women, with a couple of different women outfitters who just take their time and notice the little things. So that's kind of across the board for all big, that's what I think anyway.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
So you're out guiding, you're a guide in a lot of these places, correct?
Yep. Yeah. So what I do is I'm not so much the guide anymore. I have been.
Okay.
But now I do more hosting. So I kind of go down there. I work with different outfitters in different locations. I take care of making sure everybody in the group is having a great experience. They're happy. They have all their everything's in order.
Gotcha. Okay.
And A big thing on the hosted hunts is it's great for guys that I call single hunters. A lot of guys have these dreams and they want to do stuff, but it's the most common thing standing in their way is, well, none of my buddies wanted to go, or none of my buddies could afford it, or they weren't interested. So these hosted hunts I do, which have really taken over my schedule in a good way, I mean, it keeps me busy and it's great experience and meeting people, but it's kind of putting those guys together. And it's nerve-wracking if you're going to hunt in the jungle. Like next year, we're going to Campeche, Mexico. We're going to hunt ocelated turkey and brocket deer deep in the jungle, tent camp, like an African safari-style tent camp in the jungle. I don't think about it because I've done it so much, but I'm thinking back. I mean, that's incredibly intimidating for somebody to do who's never been there, doesn't know anyone, doesn't know the language, and is, in the end, some of these guys are by themselves. It's just not going to happen. So that's really what I do more than guide is I kind of bring the group together and I make sure everything's in order. And then I work with really good local outfitters and guides who know the animals like the back of their hand. You know what I mean? Right. So then I kind of hand off the guiding to them.
Gotcha. All right.
Yeah.
Very cool. That's a very interesting way to do it. But man, you must learn a lot. You have a lot of different clientele, you have a lot of different species, and you're working with a lot of different experts in the field of where you're going.
Yeah. For me, it's great fun to learn all this stuff. And it's interesting how it's changed the way I do hunt here in New York. Like I've only not been a guide for one season really since the end of March. I did, you know, a full season last year as a full-time guide, but now I have friends ask me, we went out to go deer hunting. It's amazing how it's changed the way I move through the woods, for example, or I approach a hunt. And it's hard for me to tell you, if you ask me, what do I do differently? It's hard for me to pinpoint one thing, 'cause it's a mindset of these little things that I met from some amazing hunters and around the world, Africa, Scotland. They all have a little bit of different view to it. And, you know, and just like anything in life, it forms you, the hunter. Everybody who's, the more you expose yourself to different styles and techniques, it's going to change your own experience and your own methodology of how you go about doing it, which is great. You know, I feel like I'm a much more, I have a keener sense when I'm out hunting now from these little things that I've picked up. I don't know. It's hard to put a finger on it, but you know, it's really, the more you learn, the more you know. And if you're smart and you pay attention, you can transfer that into your own experiences and the way you do things, without the other guy being there.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
What's your most interesting hunt you've been on?
My most interesting hunt I've been on? I would probably – there were two that really stand out. The first one is red stag hunting in Patagonia. Mm. It was nothing like I thought it was going to be.
Okay.
So you're really – you fly into this beautiful – it's San Martin – De Los Andes down in Patagonia, and the airport looks like a ski chalet. It's a great big skiing area, and they pick you up, you say hi to your outfit, and we take off for the lodge, and we drive about an hour and 2 hours, and we hit a dirt road, and he's like, well, we're on the ranch. I'm like, great. And it's still another hour and 40 minutes to the lodge. It's 140,000 acres. There's quite literally this one tiny ranch house on that entire property, and you could probably count the trees on your hand. So it's almost, it's just the surface of the moon with grass is what I liken it to. And it's just for guys out in the West, it's probably not as extreme for them. But for me, that was the coolest thing in the world to be out there. It looks desolate, but it's so full of life. And there's red stag and boar, and we saw puma and the condors. To me, that was one of the most interesting and exciting and most remarkable hunting experiences of my lifetime. And also down in Mexico, there's just something about it was my first jungle hunt.
Yeah.
So it's quite the opposite of Patagonia, where you can't see 20 yards in front of you. You're in thick, dense jungle and you're hunting. It was just we're down there for ocelated turkey. And then I came across my first brocket deer, which I found them to be, upon first viewing, was largely unimpressive when I read about them. You know, it looks like a tiny whitetail with spike horns. And once you get down there, I was blown away by how amazing those little animals are. And to hunt them in the dense jungle in the Yucatan Peninsula, that was you know, both ends of the spectrum kind of for me. And one morning while we're turkey hunting, we came, a jaguar came out of the woods, so out of the jungle. So the whole thing, I'm going back next year and I can't wait. It's one of the more amazing places I've been.
Hunting the jungle. Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, it was really cool. I know, you know, I talk about, I've hunted in South Africa. My wife's South African, so I've hunted over there a few times, and I keep saying I want to hunt the jungle in Africa as well. But yeah, jungle hunting is, it's next level stuff in my mind. For me, it's just remarkable. Gotcha. Yeah, it's wild.
So let's bring it home a little bit. Seeing that whitetail is probably the bulk of the listenership on this show. What have you learned over the years about deer hunting? What are some of the trials and tribulations and mistakes that you have made while in the whitetail woods that made you a better whitetail hunter?
Yeah, I think it goes back a lot to what I was saying about what I've learned, even with the other guys. I would rush things, and I didn't respect the animals when I was younger. And not that I didn't respect the animal as a hunter, but how incredibly in tune whitetail are to everything going on around them.
Yep.
I think where I'm hunting, it's a product of to see a big buck around here, you know, a big 4 or 5 year old buck, mature buck here in New York.
Yep.
They've been through, you'll look at them and think of them not as wild as animals in Alaska, but they've been through so much, and they've had so much contact with humans, and they've seen their knowledge of us is so vast that it really makes it more difficult for us to get within range and to hunt them well and successfully. And I think that the biggest mistakes I made were just rushing it and not taking the time to think things through with them. I've been lucky. I've hunted, like we were talking, I've hunted in several continents and a lot of different big game. And when I was out in Illinois, and I told the guys out there, I still think for me, not the most difficult as compared to climbing a mountain for a mountain goat, physically demanding, but I still think whitetails are one of the most intricate and difficult animals to hunt well and really do well and be really super successful with. A lot goes into it, man, you know?
The whitetail is always a challenge for many a hunter, and it seems like that's where most people start. You know, it's one of those things. But it's fascinating, your story. Like you started out with the whitetail, but have grown a company. Actually, grew a company to hunt all over the world.
Yeah,
absolutely fascinating.
Yeah, it's fun, and you know what I find, and I don't want to sound ungrateful, but the traveling, it's great fun, but I have a wife and children, and it can be difficult. Any of the guys, I'm not saying I don't have an amazing dream career and amazing, you know, I'm hugely grateful for it. But it's amazing that in all these things that I'm doing, sometimes I just can't wait to go deer hunting at home. There's still,
right.
It's still special. Opening day here, I jump out of bed just as excited as if you said, you know, when I'm getting ready to go to Spain next week for IBEC. It's opening day, dude. It's home. Like, I'm going to my woods. To me, there's something about I'm hunting my woods, my spots, my deer, and the places to get in a tree stand that I've been hunting for 20 years, and I've sat 20 opening days in the same area. Like, that's cool as hell to me. I look forward to it as much or more than anything else. And when I think about exposing my children to it and teaching them, I can't wait to get them out in our woods. You know, and I think that's the connection with a lot of guys in the whitetail deer is the how personal it becomes, at least for me. Like, all this stuff I'm saying, I'm the guy, I never tell anybody the best way to do anything. I just tell you what works for me and what I feel. And that's really how I look at the deer hunting around here. It's always going to be special.
It's funny you mentioned that, because I don't share this with a lot of people. I've come to that same conclusion. Like, there are many places in the country that I can go hunt because of friends I've made through this show. And I certainly enjoy going out and seeing what the rest of the deer world looks like in different aspects of a hunt somewhere else in Ohio, Maryland, North Carolina, out west. But there is something very special about the woods in which I live. And yes, it's not the best deer hunting state in the country. It doesn't hold the biggest rack deer. It doesn't hold the biggest body deer. There's a whole new element to hunting 85-86% timber. But they're my woods, and it's the woods that I understand. It's the woods that I smell and study every day. It's my easiest access. So yes, there is something very special about coming back and hunting your own woods. And it's a bit difficult to explain, but you're right. There is something about it.
Yeah. And it's not, it's always going to be special. And it's, if somebody asks me my favorite place, it's still one of my favorite places to be. Not saying if someone came, calls me up tomorrow and says, hey, you can either go hunt your woods next week or I'll take you out for a stone sheep. Like I'm going to go jump all over a stone sheep. It's not that I would take that over all these other things, but I kind of liken it to go to a great restaurant. I've been to some amazing restaurants like in New York City, yep. World-class food. Mm-hmm. But if you ask me death row dinner, like what's your last meal going to be? It's going to be like chicken cutlets and mashed potatoes that my mom had the recipe and makes for me.
Right, you know what I mean?
I've had amazing cuisine, but you know, when it comes down to it, what's ingrained in you and what you look forward to is that connection to home and the comfort and I'm trying to think of a word, but I think everybody knows it. You feel it. You can't put it into words how you feel. It's a special place because it's home, really.
Right, right. Yeah, home is a special place.
Yeah, no matter what you do.
When you go into the woods, tell us about your styles of hunting you do at home, deer hunting, the gear you use, the strategies you use. Are you a tree stand guy? Are you on the ground guy? Are you a tracker guy? Or are you a still hunter guy? Let's go through your kind of protocol at home.
Yeah, at home, I'm largely, I love tree stand hunting. A lot of people think I know guys who love to stalk and they say the tree stand's boring, but I love getting up in there. I love putting in the work to pattern the deer. It's fun during the off season to have some cameras out, or even more than that, I don't have a ton of cameras, but I like to get out there at sunset or sunrise and glass the field edges and, you know, put in the work to see where I'm going to go in the setup. To me, that's part of the fun. Before I had children, I was always up a tree. That's it. End of subject. I love tree stands. I started when I was in my 20s and I had unlimited energy. I climbed every tree with a lock on tree stand on my back, a climber rather, because I can go wherever I wanted. Then, you know, I started putting in a little more work and I had properties that were just, I had permission to be on, you know, very private properties. And I put out the tree stands and I did that for years. Something that's new to me is hunting from ground and ground blinds, because with a 9-year-old and an 11-year-old, and especially when they were even younger, I wanted to share that experience with them. So I started, and it's a very different game, paying attention to hiding the blinds and your approach to them. And, you know, now we're not wearing camo. Now we're dressing in darker clothes and just different, the little nuances of blind hunting. Over the last 5 or 6 years, I don't say they've taken over, but they've become a bigger part of my repertoire of the way I go about it. For me, growing up and cutting my teeth in Westchester, I still prefer bow hunting to other types of hunting. Not that I'm a staunch bow hunter. I love to take out my Browning A-bolt or, you know, the Mossberg and get up in the tree and hunt, because my wife, growing up in South Africa, she has a standing order and she wants does. She wants 1.5-year-old does, at least 3 of them before I go screwing around chasing bucks. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
It's for her, it's about, I went out duck hunting once last year, for example. I woke up and she says, that looks like duck camo. This is at 4 a.m. I said, yeah. And she says, how many ducks does it take to fill my freezer? And I'm like, oh, okay, I guess I'll go deer hunting tomorrow. Because my family, and I think, you know, you follow me on social media and stuff. My family, we eat. At home, it's almost exclusively game. I do a lot of cooking. And so, yeah, the deer hunting is a big part of the culture of how I'm bringing up my children. The hunting aspect, the respect for game, and also it is how we feed ourselves. So,
no kidding. I mean, all right.
Yeah, so it's been – I mean, we eat venison for probably 3-4 days a week in some form or another. But, yeah, it's I've gotten off point a little bit. But, yeah, that's kind of it.
Right. So having a family to feed the game, what are some of your favorite venison dishes? I would imagine that cooking is almost a favorite pastime in your household, is my guess.
Yeah. Yeah. We have the favorites are, I grew up in an Italian household, so there's always a venison bolognese going on. That's
wow.
A couple times a month. Yeah, the bolognese, the pasta, meatballs. I mean, I just, before we got on the air here, I just ate a big bowl full of amazing venison meatballs we prepared the other day, 2 days ago. but yeah, stuff like that. I butcher a lot of my own, and while I do full butchering job, there's always one or two deer where it's like loins and premium cuts, and then we grind the meat. And it's not because it's easy or whatever, and or it's tougher meat. It's just because we love what you can do with all that. And the shepherd's pies and my wife's South African, so there's a lunch called babuti, which is a casserole with ground meat in it. Tacos, I mean, my kids, you know, just all sorts of – the base of what we do is really just home-style comfort food. And then I do, as a guy who likes to cook, when I have some time on a weekend, I'll go all out. And I did. I shot a big black bear here 2 years ago, and I made ossobuco with the black bear. Spent the day cooking it.
No kidding.
Yeah. Wow. So all of a sudden, I brought it to work. A couple of guys had it, and it became like this thing where guys were coming to hunt with me and stay at my house, and they were putting in. I have friends. They put in requests, and you know, 2 years ago, I think we were eating ossobuco twice a week through the hunting season, because as my buddies rotate through here, that was the request. So yeah, so I do like to play mix it up. I have a couple of, I stay in touch with a lot of guys on social media who are great chefs. I'm friends with a gentleman, a lot of guys might know, Hank Shaw, came out with an amazing cookbook.
Sure. Yeah.
And when it came out, I went down to New York City when he was signing, and we had a great time hanging out. And, but I look for a lot of inspiration from guys like that. Field to Plate is a buddy of mine. He's on Jeremiah. He's on Instagram, and he does really home cooked comfort food. Almost is his specialty. He gets fancy once in a while, but that's the kind of stuff I love to do. I mean, the cooking for me is as much fun as anything. I love it.
It's funny you mentioned Hank Shaw. I'm actually looking at Buck Moose right now. It's on my desk as we're talking.
Yeah, man. Yeah, Hank knows the stuff. You know, he has. And Hank does, there's some things Hank does that I just don't have the time and the ability to do. He makes incredible meals out of egg corns that he makes into flour and all that. But his recipes are on point, and he's a funny dude. He's a lot of fun. He's an interesting guy. So it was one of those things where it all, after I got to know him a little more, I wanted more and more to cook his recipes. And I do that with my other buddy, Jeremiah. Every time I turn around, he's posting something, and I get inspired, yeah. And then I'm tweaking it and messing with it and having a good time. And, you know, I enjoy the cooking. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And when you see me, 250-pound dude, there's no mistaking that I like to eat when you see me.
I'm in the same boat with you. No problem there. And I got this book, this cookbook called Wild Gourmet, and it's a Boone and Crockett publication in which Hank was featured in that with some of his recipes. And I also got this Buck Moose from Hank, and I was going through it trying to come up with a venison dish for Thanksgiving, and turns out there's a couple of blood stains, a couple of venison blood stains on the cookbook now. I don't remember doing that, but it's there. And I made a fantastic venison pot pie, basically. It's a venison pie. It's a meat pie for Thanksgiving, and brought it out to my friend Jeff's place, and where most of us were going to. I ate a lot of it for the dinner, but but when it was time to go get pie, regular pie for dessert, Jeff went back to the meat pie. You know, that's how good it was. So I like to cook, and I think you and I would get along real good if we got into deer camp and spent some time in the kitchen.
Yeah, that's one of the things. But the social media thing has changed. I've done a lot. People found the stuff I do on social media, and more people follow. And it's kind of funny when I go to a media camp. I did a turkey media camp out in Oklahoma with some writers. And when I get there, I didn't plan on it. I hadn't thought of it. And they're all like, "So what are you cooking for us?" And I was like, I was just out there to help with the group. And I did do a little bit of guiding there. Next thing I find myself in town and getting supplies and making, you know, turkey or chicken piccata for the group and all this other stuff, because they've been following me on social media. And,
yeah.
And, you know, I have some other things going on right now that we're developing as far as cooking and the hunting and cooking aspect. But yeah, it's who I am. This is how we live our life. It's not it's fun that people follow along and appreciate it. And it helps bring more people to World Slam and to meet me. It's always fun to meet new people through that stuff. And it's always fun. I love when I hear somebody say that they're, you know, they love the cooking and the hunting. And it's like I said, this is who I am and how I'm raising my family. And it's a lot of fun.
Right. Gotcha.
Yeah.
So you're also exploring some podcasting, if I read that correctly.
Yeah. So I did a little podcast with Ray I, who's a very well-known turkey hunter, and my buddy Mark Strand, who is the editor of Midwest Outdoors. We did that a little time ago, and
yeah.
I've been working on some stuff. I have one of my best friends, I mean, he's family, is a gentleman named Lou Mangiello, and he has a podcast. It's a Disney podcast, which seems, you know, from a lot of people, they would kind of laugh at it, but his podcast, it's in, you know, he's up there at one of the top 10 podcasts ever, and he's regularly in the top 10. When you consider there's 350,000 podcasts in the world.
Right.
You know, and it's funny, he was a lawyer, and a story kind of like mine, he was a lawyer who did this Disney thing and wrote a book, and it snowballed, and he's a full-time podcaster. So I've been doing a lot of stuff with him. People kind of laugh because I dabble and help him with a Disney podcast of all things.
Right.
I mean, yeah, but guys, if you follow me long enough or if we're friends on social media, you start to see when I'm not hunting, I'm standing there taking pictures with Mickey Mouse. I'm silly like that. But yeah, I'm starting to get into it more and more. I've done it in the past a little bit, and you know, I have the best intentions to do things sooner, but I guess I'm lucky in that other things I've had things get in my way, but it's all good stuff. It's kind of a really good life is unfolding, and careers have been unfolding. And so the podcasting got bumped a little bit.
Gotcha. So but the Disney podcast is actually about going to Disney, or it's a Disney.
It's not a Disney product, but he talks about Disney World and,
yeah.
You know, his thing is helping you to have the best Disney vacation possible and the best experience. And, gotcha. You know, it's the number one travel destination in the world, whether people know it or not. It's huge. But he was just a great inspiration as a guy who was a lawyer.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? And now he's just doing what he loves doing. And I used to he's like family. I used to call him up and tell him to get a real job. And I'm like, dude, get a job. And now that I'm kind of doing this, he's returning the favor by giving me a hard time about not having a job, in quotes. You know what I mean?
right. Gotcha.
But yeah, he's been a huge influence on me with he's an incredible entrepreneur and all that. So yeah, you know, I got it. Like I said, I get off topic a lot. My brain tends to ramble at this point.
That's okay. We like getting off topic and coming back.
So, yeah, man. But that's it. So the podcast, you're getting back to the podcast. Yeah, it's something I love to do, and it'll be fun to. I like the interaction of the podcast. I find podcasts very personal. You know, people are downloading them and listening to them in their own time. It's not like a rush thing, so you can really sit back, enjoy it, and get to know people a little better, hopefully. Right. I know it seems a lot of one way, but I'd like to do something, figure out ways to do things more back and forth like you guys do. Yep.
Yeah, completely understand.
Yeah, it's cool.
One of the things I wanted to kind of explore with you a little bit is a memorable deer hunt. I know we talked about a couple of hunts, but is there a hunt that maybe sticks out a little bit more in your head that really is on the top of your head and is important to you? I was wondering if we might be able to recreate that a little bit and go step by step, and maybe like we're there with you. Is there one that comes to mind?
On a deer hunt?
Yeah.
It's, you know, when the most memorable, I'll never forget the first deer I ever took. Like, I already mentioned to you the kind of the mistakes I've made when I was an early, you know, starting out, but,
yeah.
The very first deer I ever hunted, I was bow hunting. And I know, thinking back now, I wasn't paying attention to wind. I was noisy going in and out of the woods. I was rushing out to the tree stand after work. So I probably stunk like hell. But I remember the first deer I ever took was back in 1990. And I went out, it was the end of the season in New York, December 29th, season ended on the 31st. I had hunted my butt off all season. I hadn't killed a deer. And I get out there and I was sick. I had like 102 fever, but I knew the season was almost over and I really wanted to do it. And I remember climbing. I couldn't get up in the morning. I got up, took a shower, got in my tree stand about 1 p.m. And as soon as I get in my tree stand and I pull my bow up, here comes a doe. And it's a young doe all by herself. And everything went right. She came in the right side of the wind. I drew back. I made a beautiful shot. I see her bound up the hill and drop within 40 yards. And I was shaking. I remember I had to sit down for a minute. I was shaking so badly. You know, and it was the doe. She probably weighed 90 pounds. Tiny little thing. I lower my bow. I start climbing down to my tree stand, the climbing stand. I hop out. I go over to the deer. And I remember it was very emotional. I'm freaking out. I'm sick as could be. But then I walk back over to get my tree stand. And the tree stand is about 15 feet in the air. I was so excited. I climbed down, and in my mind, I was like, close enough. And I'm lucky I didn't break my legs. But I got the deer out of the woods. I realized that, I don't know if it was when I jumped, I couldn't find my knife. So I had to take this deer out like she was back to my car. I get home, and I had to go back with my brother and a ladder in the dark to get my damn climbing tree stand. I was so excited. I jumped out of it 12, 15 feet in the air.
Excitement, you know? And adrenaline as a young man. I can see.
Yeah.
I can see myself doing that. I'd never do that today because I know how much that would hurt. But
yeah. Oh, no. At 46 years old, it's not happening. Yeah. At 20 years old.
Yeah.
I'm going to let you in a secret. When I was 20 years old, I was bulletproof. I mean, I was nothing.
Sure.
Hurt me, you know,
same here,
but I didn't even realize I did it. I just thought I was close enough, but it was every bit of 12 to 15 feet.
Yeah.
And I'm lucky. So that's the one. And I guess it sounds a little corny, my first deer story, but yeah, to me, nothing. That's when it just all clicked and I really got the bug. And, you know, I was going to be able to, I went home and made dinner for my, not that night, but once we butchered the animal, made dinner for my family. It was a great feeling. And ever since then, the hunting and cooking and family part of it has been, I keep coming back to that, but yeah, that's where it's at for me. That's what I love more as much as anything else.
That's so cool. Very cool.
Yeah.
I have 10 rapid fire questions for you here, Tony.
Man.
Okay. All right. Bring it on. Right.
Yeah.
All right. I have not prepped you for these, but let's.
No, I didn't know about this.
Okay. Yeah. What's your number one hunting tip of all time?
My number is to be patient. Like I said earlier, Take your time with this stuff. These animals are not on your clock. No matter you think you have 2 minutes to get it done, they don't care that you have to go to work in the morning or do this. Just take your time and you'll have more success, I think.
Right. Good one. All right. We all have these, well, most of us have these things, not everybody, but a lot of us have these things that we take in the woods with us, not necessarily a part of the hunt or a utility piece of the hunt, but it's more like a good luck charm or just something that we feel like we need to have with us or we feel kind of naked out there. Do you have one of those items?
Peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I've turned my car around and gone home because I left the sandwich there. And it's not about having the sandwich. To me, I'm not a superstitious guy, but a lot of my deer hunting was always in the morning because of my schedule. Yeah. And I don't know why, but that's, yeah. My buddies actually make fun of me about that because I usually flip everybody's sandwiches. We're going out into the woods. They expect it at this point.
Right. Got to have my peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
Peanut butter and jelly.
Yeah. I love it.
I can't believe I said that out loud, but yeah, that's the way it goes. Right.
What's your biggest pet peeve in life?
My biggest pet peeve? That's a tough one. I don't – in the hunt – as far as hunting goes, my biggest pet peeve is guys who are disrespectful of the whole process and the game and everything. There's a lot of – I don't – this is – and I think it also stems back to giving a bad view on hunters. I know, and I've come across a lot of guys where the hunting, and I don't want to say a lot of guys and give hunters a bad name, but the guys who make it a macho thing, that's the only thing that bothers me. Like this is, for me, you know, hunting is about where we came from and it's about being back in touch with nature. And it sounds corny, but that's really truly what I love about it. And guys who take away from that by making it about them I'm not saying I don't love to hunt big trophy deer and big animals, but don't make it about the number of inches. Like really just have a good time and teach new people that as the base. I guess to me, that's what it's about. And that's one of my pet peeves about hunting.
Okay. All right. Yeah. You're 46 years old today.
Yeah.
As am I, actually. What would you tell? Yeah, I know. It's, you know, 20 years old and bulletproof. I understand where you're coming from. That's how I understand that. What would you tell the 20-year-old Tony Caggiano, knowing what you know today?
About hunting or about life?
Life.
Pay better attention to what's going on around you and just be open to new things. I think when I was younger, I had this kind of a vision about what the way everything had to be. And as I got older, these opportunities came in front of me, and some of them I passed up on earlier. And once I started to open myself up to those opportunities and, you know, things like that, life changed. Let people in, and I got to know a lot of great people. And I know I have friends from, you know, guys who are billionaires and that people know well, you know, kind of celebrities that are good friends, down to guys who, you know, I have friends who were in incarcerated, and I've learned something from all different people. So it's just being open to new things and paying attention.
Gotcha. Okay.
That might sound a little random, but I don't know. That's a tough question, man, for right. You throwing that at me. You could have gave me a heads up on that one.
No, they're way better when I don't give you a heads up.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
All right. You meet a stranger at a hotel convention lobby, like a hunting convention, and they ask you what you do for a living. What do you tell them?
I tell – if somebody asks me, you know, it's not like an elevator pitch. I tell them about I am a professional hunter, and I'm a booking – you know, I work as a travel agent, and I kind of – usually start a conversation to let them know, because it's hard for me to give my job in a single sentence as
right.
Because I'm trying to do, I feel like I'm trying to do something a little differently than a lot of guys. I'm trying to offer these experiences. So I usually kind of start a conversation and open it up to that.
Gotcha. Okay.
You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Totally makes sense.
It's always one of those things where it's always,
there's no direct answer.
Mm-hmm. You know, I kind of tell them about World Slam and tell them about my work in Argentina, because that's a huge part of what I do, and take it from there.
And I asked the question because it's a personality reflector. Some people will just give a quick one-word answer and move on if you're talking to somebody, you know, or they'll make something up. Like, that's not really my profession, because they really don't want to talk to you. Or, you know, sometimes they want to carry on a conversation, explain to you in detail kind of what you do, or have that conversation with a total stranger. So it's more of a what do you do to a total stranger kind of question than what do you say when they ask you the question?
That goes back to the advice I give myself years ago is, strangers, I was always very, growing up in New York City, I was always leery of strangers. I was always,
sure.
You grow up with this attitude down there, like growing up in the Bronx, where you got to watch out because everyone's out to get you.
Right.
When you grow up in a tougher neighborhood.
And right. Stranger
danger. As I got away from that. Yep. Yeah. Strange danger. As I got away from that, I love sitting down and meeting new people, and there's no such thing, as you could probably tell by listening to me ramble on, there's no such thing as a if I have the time, I love to get in a conversation with new people.
Yeah. It is funny. So, like, and even growing up in rural New Hampshire, we always had the stigma like, man, don't go to New York City. That's a bad place. It's trouble, especially the Bronx.
Yeah. That wasn't New York City. That was the Bronx.
Right. You know, right. Yeah. Different. Oh, that's bad news. You're lucky if you come home, if you go down there.
Yeah. And it was tough back then. It's changed. It's different. In a good, some good ways, some bad ways, but you know, it did. It certainly made me the person I am today. Yep. It's one of those things where I'm so glad I grew up there, but in a way, I'm glad my children aren't growing up there. Not saying anything bad about the people in the Bronx, but it's, I'm being honest. Yeah.
Yep. I think you already answered the next question, but we'll go to it again. What did you have for breakfast this morning?
I skipped breakfast and I ate a bunch of venison meatballs right before we got on the air. Yeah, I'm good for that. Like, I'm kind of like a black bear. If I like it, I'll eat it at any time of the day. I don't care. There's no breakfast food. You know, I'll sit down and eat a big bowl of venison stew for breakfast.
The omnivore opportunist.
Yeah, that's me.
Right. Me too. You get your own billboard on the side of a highway. It starts out as a blank canvas. You can put anything you want on it. What would it say?
Oh, hell. You see, now, I don't know that I would advertise my company necessarily on there, if that's what you're thinking, because I don't know if that's the target market for me and if that's how I do it, but,
You may have a more global perspective on what you, about people's lives. You know, what do you want to inspire them to do?
Yeah, I don't know exactly, cause I don't know exactly how I think, cause this is something I'd like to think on more, but, I would like to have the billboard talk more about, how hunters are conservation, because it comes down to, I mean, I'm constantly having this discussion. It's not an argument for me, because when people get hostile, I've had, like I was telling you about the Disney thing. So it's a really varied community that I've been introduced to through that stuff. And I've had vegans, staunch vegans, like approach me hostile. And I said, and I flat out tell them, like, if you want to sit down and have a discussion, we could do that. And, you know, as crazy as it sounds, I'm on Facebook. I have whatever, 5,000 friends. I have friends on there who are vegan animal activist types, but they're still friends and they don't attack me and I don't attack them. I know that's the decision they made. I don't think it's right, correct, but I at least want them to be informed as to why I do it and why the facts of why hunters are conservation.
Right.
So I would have to, that's what the billboard would be, something to that effect. Not marketing anything, not selling anything, just educating people about what I love.
Right. I love that answer, Tony. Absolutely love that answer.
Yeah.
If I say the word successful, who's the first person that pops into your head and why?
The first person. Man, where the hell did you get these? Did you just try to find questions that are going to be?
Yes.
The first.
Maybe there's nobody, you know?
I don't know. It sounds arrogant. Like I'm really happy with, I get to do what I love to do. And so it's really, and I'm trying to think of people who get to do that. Like, it's not about money, the success thing for me. It's just, I was in corporate insurance for a while. I had a stint in that and I made more money. You can make more money in a year than you make it 20 years as a guide. And when I told my wife, I closed this huge deal and I came home, my wife said, how'd it go? I said, great. And I said, I think I'm going to quit the day I closed the biggest deal. And she said to me, thank goodness I liked you better as a hunting guide.
Right.
So I don't know, but people that are doing that, maybe my wife, man.
There you go. Right.
She's got it all figured out. She works hard. She grew up in South Africa. She came here. We met. She works hard. She's one of the happiest people I ever met. Everybody loves her. She's so positive every day. When I get down, she's like, today's the day. This is going to happen. She's always that way. So it's probably my wife, man. Thinking about, you know, you made me think about this here and I'm getting a little sappy, but.
But you know. I can see.
And she married me. So who's the big winner? No, all kidding aside. Yeah.
That's an admirable trait right there.
We've had this, and I just had this discussion the other day. Where I am now is a direct result of who she is. And it's for her, it's all about her family. So
the
focus now in this house is for her to find her bliss and something she loves. And, you know, that's why we're actually relocating to Florida when we sell our home. It'll be good for business, but mostly it's about her and her friends who are down there and following her career, which is still kind of a windy road, but yeah.
Right. Right. Very cool. I like that answer a lot.
Thanks.
What's a typical day in your life look like?
Yeah. So if you follow me on Instagram, it looks like I'm out hunting and doing all this, but 90% of the time it's, drop my kids off at school.
Yep.
Hit the gym for an hour. And I the reason I hit the gym is so I can hunt. Like, and then I come back here and I'm not complaining, mind you, but it's a remarkable amount of time in front of a computer. I don't think people realize how much back end stuff there is. You're having your own business and arranging all these things. So an average day it's computer time until my kids get out of school. Then I pick them up and then it's really their time. And maybe when they go to bed, it'll just be my wife and I. Like, I'm really lucky in that I get to do what I love to do. And when I first started doing it, I was just consumed by it. But now I really try to make more time for my family. So it's pretty cool.
Very nice. You
know? But some days, you know, I'm not going to lie to you. Like, my uniform could be a pair of pajama pants and a baseball hat on backwards and a cup of coffee. Like, that's
right. Right.
Like, wow, where's, you know, look at Instagram. Oh, you know, I posted today, it was photos. Yesterday it was photos from Argentina. And, you know, I posted those when I'm sitting there in a pair of my Darth Vader pajama pants. Living the dream.
Darth Vader. All right, man. There's a visual. There's a visual. All right.
But yeah, but that's, you know, a typical day. It's, I put a lot of work into it. There's a lot of work that goes into it and there's great benefits. And like next week I'll be heading out to Spain to go hunt there. So, across the, there's nothing typical about my day, but I'd have to say that that's kind of a day at home.
Okay. And if you have a hunting day, what's a normal hunting day look like for you?
Hunting day? Yeah, it depends. During deer season, I mean, my plan was to go deer hunting this morning before we spoke, but I had a friend come into town and we wound up staying up till like 3 a.m.
Yep.
Catching up.
Yep.
Went over and visited him. So I bagged it and I just worked this morning. But usually I like getting up early after years of being a guide. You just kind of get used to it.
Yep.
And, get up early and get out in my tree stand. And like I said, I got my peanut butter and jelly sandwich, watch the sunrise.
Nice.
And see how it goes, you know.
That's cool.
I used to hunt all day. And sometimes if it's during the rut or something, I'll do all day sits, but something has to click for me to make me want to do that. And I can't tell you what it is. Sometimes you just feel like I think it's going to happen. But usually I hunt till 11 o'clock, come back, catch up on some work and head back out. This time of year, head back out at 1, you know.
Gotcha. Okay.
Sunset. Yeah.
All right. Well, those are the 10 rapid fire questions. Did excellent for not prepping you for any of them.
Nice job. What's my grade? You're going to grade those?
I'm going to give you an A plus.
Well, now you're just sucking up to me.
Yeah.
Thanks, man.
Dude, you named your wife as your most successful person. How can I not give you an A plus?
Yeah, well, I'm trying to, I got more hunts to go away on, so I just got to butter her up a little bit.
It was an A until you said my wife. Then I gave you a plus.
Oh, well, I'm not going to let her know that. It'll go to her head.
So, Tony, this has been great, and if we haven't covered enough material here for people that are listening, they want more information about you and Wold Slam, where can we go to get more information?
So for Wold Slam, you can check out worldslamadventures.com to get a little bit more information on everything that I'm doing between Wold Slam and my Argentina stuff and some of the new things that I got. I have a website. It's just Tony Caggiano, C-A-G-G-I-A-N-O, TonyCaggianoOutdoors.com. And you know, if guys are interested, find me on Instagram or Facebook. And I spend a lot of time talking with people and doing things out there. I have a love-hate relationship with what social media has done to hunting, but I like to keep it positive. And I'm always looking for other guys like that to find on there. And you meet some amazing people like that, I think. So it's a lot of fun. So reach out to me in any of those places. Shoot me an email. No, always happy to talk hunting for sure, man.
Very cool. Tony, it's been an honor and a pleasure to have you on the show, and maybe we can do this again sometime.
My pleasure. This is all mine, man. Thanks for asking.
Thanks to Tony Caggiano for joining us on the Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast. It was it's very interesting to hear how he started Wold Slam Adventures, where he was really just trying to book a turkey hunt and wasn't getting a whole lot of good information from the travel agent themselves. You know, there's probably a better ways. After talking to his friends, he started to put it all together and then figured out that he could offer it to other people and make that experience world class. But I really like that Tony still found time and still deeply enjoys, as I do, coming home to hunt your own woods. There's just something about your own deer woods that's something special. But Dusty, do we have a Chubby Tines tip of the week?
Yeah, it's something that...
The Chubby Tines Tip of the Week is sponsored by Morse's Sporting Goods. Firearms, use firearms. Bows, use bows. Located at 85 Kentuckook Falls Road in Hillsborough, New Hampshire. Give Jim a call at 603-464-3444, morsessportinggoods.com. Your dollars go further in New Hampshire. There's no sales tax. Morse's Sporting Goods.
Learned at quite a younger age, and it's something that I always try to pass along. And I'm hoping out there that somebody that don't have the knowledge of this, but a buck deer will drag their feet in the snow.
Mm. Yes, that is true. One of those things to separate your tracking abilities. I've seen it firsthand, and it's a good clue, and it works. I've tracked a buck because of that exact situation, because of that exact pattern in the snow. I could tell it was a buck and ended up almost getting that shot. And that was that one shot that my gun scope fogged up and I couldn't get a shot before he ran off. And that was a good buck too. But it works. It works. Very nice. Dusty, where can we find you when you're not hanging out here in the studios with me?
Shoot me an email, dusty@bigbuckregistry.com. You can look me up on Instagram and Twitter @ChasingAntler, facebook.com/ChubbyTinesOutdoors. Jay, where can the people reach out to you when you're not on the mic?
Likewise, you can shoot me an email, jay@bigbuckregistry.com, and you can visit us on Facebook, facebook.com/bigbuckregistry. We're also on Twitter, which is twitter.com/bigbuckregistry. We are also on Instagram, instagram.com/bigbuckregistry, and YouTube, which is youtube.com/bigbuckregistry. On YouTube, you can listen to all of our podcasts in their entirety. As far as videos are concerned, it's a boring video, but the audio content is there, so you can actually listen to our podcast. You can also listen to all of our live shows that we've done on Thursday nights when we do them, and we've gone back and re-interviewed a lot of our previous guests we had on the show just to put a face to a voice. Let's put it that way. You can always listen to our show on other places as well, not just YouTube. We're found on iTunes, iHeartRadio, TuneIn Radio, Stitcher, and Blueberry. And if you would like to submit a buck to our page for consideration and be featured on our page in front of 250,000 diehard deer hunting fans, all you have to do is go to bigbuckregistry.com/mybuck, and all of the instructions will be right there. I think that's pretty much everywhere we're at. I think that's a wrap, Dusty.
That's a whole lot of big buck, Jay.
Sure is. I'm Jay Scott.
I'm Dusty Phillips.
And this is the Big Buck Registry's Deer Hunting Podcast. We'll see you next week.
Yeah.